Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. The case we'll be talking about today is the unsolved murder of 16-year-old Jeanette De Palma. She was killed just days after her 16th birthday in August of 1972. A lot of people say that this case was kind of the start of the satanic panic that America went through in the 70s and especially the 80s. America had been experiencing a culture shift, and to deal with this, a lot of people blamed things like the newly formed Church of Satan, witches, the occult, and the devil on influencing young people through different outlets, music especially. But for this area that Jeanette was from, there was a lot more going on than the broad cultural shifts, and it is important to talk about some of the other tragic events that had occurred around the time of Jeanette's death to give more of a complete picture. So this video will likely be split into two parts. A lot of my information is coming from interviews with many of the people involved in the case, including investigators and Jeanette's family members. The interviews were conducted by Jesse Pollack, who is one of the two authors of the book, The Death on the Devil's Teeth. If you're interested, I highly suggest you listening to these interviews. You can find them on Jesse's YouTube channel as well as his podcast. All of that information will be linked in the description, including the information on how to purchase the book Death on the Devil's Teeth that Jesse Pollack wrote with Mark Moran. I did focus a lot of my research for this video on Jesse Pollack's podcast because of the recorded interviews. I like being able to hear the information the way it was directly given from the people involved. I do my best to give accurate information, but like always, if I got something wrong, please kindly post that in the comments. Jeanette De Palma was born on August 3, 1956, in Jersey City, New Jersey, to parents Sal and Florence De Palma. During the summer of 1972, Jeanette and her family lived in Springfield County, New Jersey, on Clearview Road. It was a nice, safe area in an upper-middle-class neighborhood, and it was perfect for raising a family. Her family had converted from Roman Catholic to Evangelist and attended the Assemblies of God Evangel Church. There is some controversy as to how religious the family was, as well as how religious Jeanette was, but we'll get more into that later. Jeanette attended Jonathan Dayton High School and would be starting her junior year when summer ended. She had a lot of friends and seemed to be just like any other teenager at the time. Things in the 70s were very different from how a lot of things are today. Things like hitchhiking were still pretty common, even though parents were very wary and didn't want their kids doing it. Some still did. Jeanette's friend said she would often hitchhike, though only with people that she knew. But even if that was true, that could mean that she would get a ride from anybody that she was familiar with. And that doesn't mean you necessarily know them. Like, they could be an acquaintance from school that you don't really know. On the morning of August 7th, 1972, Jeanette had plans with her friend Gail Donahue to hang out at Gail's house with two boys that they had recently met in Echo Lake Park in Mountainside. After hanging out with them, Jeanette would go to work from there. She worked that evening at a telemarketing job that her and Gail both had over the summer. Jeanette had breakfast like normal that morning, but then her parents sat her down and told her that her cousin was missing. This cousin was known to run away sometimes, but she would always come home after a few days. But this time it was different. She had been gone for over a week. This really upset Jeanette, and not just because her cousin was missing, but also that her parents would wait so long before telling her about it. This caused a fight between Jeanette and her parents, and she ended their conversation and went to her room. She then called Gail and told her that she had to cancel their plans for the day because her mom was making her clean the bathroom. This attempt to get out of their plans would never really be explained, and it's unknown why Jeanette was trying to get out of it. Gail wasn't having it, though, and convinced Jeanette to still come over. Jeanette quickly cleaned the bathroom and told her mom that she was going to walk the 3 miles to the train station and then take the train the rest of the way to Gail's. Jeanette's mom offered to give her a ride, but Jeanette declined. It was August. I'm sure it was a nice hot day, one of the only few left, and walking the 3 miles wasn't that out of the ordinary for Jeanette. But she wasn't being honest with her mom, because Jeanette told Gail that she was planning on hitchhiking to Gail's house. Jeanette asked her sister, Cindy, if she wanted to go with her to Jeanette's house, but her sister had other plans and declined. She also called a different friend to see if she would go with her to Gail's house, but this friend also declined. She even stopped at another friend's house, Donna Blattis, but again, had no luck. She then asked Donna's mom if she could get a ride from her, but she was unable to. Maybe Jeanette wanted someone to go with her so she could get a ride, but if that was the case, why wouldn't she have just accepted the offer from her mom? Either way, Jeanette had no luck of getting anyone to join her. And off she went, walking down the street. This was the last time Jeanette was seen alive. Jeanette's parents called the police to report Jeanette missing when she didn't come home later that night from work. The police unfortunately told them that they had to wait 24 hours to file a report. So once the 24 hours passed, they filed it. There are conflicting statements, though, on the type of report filed. Jeanette's parents say that they tried to file her as a missing person, but the police say that Jeanette's parents said that she ran away. Either way, Jeanette was reported as a runaway. So because of this, significantly less resources were used to try and find her in the first few weeks. Jeanette had been missing for 6 weeks when, on September 19, 1972, a gruesome discovery was made. The landlord of the Gardens apartment complex called the police after finding a human arm outside by one of the entrances of the complex. Initially, the Springfield police investigator thought that maybe it wasn't really an arm and that maybe it was just a prank. Apparently, there were some kids at the apartment complex that would mess around with the landlord. They would rip open trash bags and throw the trash all over the yard. So the Springfield police had been called several times to the complex over these boys. So at first, the investigators thought it was just a prank they were pulling. But as soon as they got there, they quickly realized that this was in fact a human arm. They figured out that it was one of the tenant's dogs that brought the arm to the complex while he was outside running without a leash. A search began that afternoon at 3 p.m. to find the rest of the body the arm came from. The Springfield police sought help from neighboring departments because they were a pretty small force and didn't have a lot of equipment that was needed to conduct a search like this. Officers from the neighboring towns brought bloodhounds because the Springfield Police Department had none. About a half an hour into the search, they began searching a wooded area off Mountain View Road. They went over a hill, across a creek, and into a quarry. This area was actually privately owned by a construction site. They went up a steep hill, and on top of this hill was a flat area around 20 feet around. And it was there where they found a body. The body was badly decomposed and was found with no shoes, but flip-flops were nearby. There is a discrepancy between some of the officers as to how her body was positioned. According to one officer, her body was face down, but her actual head and face were positioned more on its side with her legs in a bent position. Others say she was all the way face down. This will be important later. There are also differing accounts of the crime scene itself. Some officers say that there were a lot of just fallen branches from trees around on the ground, along with a log above and below the body. Others say that there were also logs on the side of her body, forming a sort of coffin or casket. And the branches weren't just randomly placed on the ground. They were between the body and the logs placed together to form crosses. Some say there were rocks around her head, forming what looked like a halo. The crime scene photos were never released, and due to circumstances we will get into later, will likely never be released. The police checked her pocketbook that was nearby for any evidence of drugs or any identification, but none were found. The coroner tested her for drugs, but because the body was so decomposed, the coroner wasn't able to test any of her organs, which is ideal, but were able to use tissue off of her scalp. And at this point, the investigators still weren't sure who this was, but they did suspect that it was Jeanette. So they contacted her dentist to come to the temporary morgue that was made up in the funeral parlor to compare the teeth of the body to Jeanette's dental records. And they found that it was, in fact, Jeanette. Because the body was so decomposed, the coroner was unable to find the cause of death. There was no obvious trauma, no bullet wounds. Though the Union County Medical Examiner's Office found enough evidence during the autopsy to suggest Jeanette may have been strangled. The toxicology report came back negative for any drugs or alcohol. It did come back with high concentration of lead, But they didn't take any soil samples from around the crime scene to test also, so they're not sure, but it's likely that the high amount of lead was due to the area that her body was lying in. It was a construction company property, and high levels of lead in the soil would be common, especially in the 1970s, because they still use lead in a lot of things like paint and gasoline. I want to note, though, that the coroner was a medical doctor, not a pathologist, and did not have any formal education specializing in pathology or forensics. Jeanette's friend Lisa went to the crime scene a couple days after Jeanette's body was found. The area was still roped off, and she said she could see where Jeanette's body was located due to the impressions made in the ground. According to this friend, there was a large log above her head and a smaller log where her feet were, and a log on each side of her body, making it look like a coffin. Inside the logs were multiple crosses made up of fallen tree branches on both sides of her body. Officer Don's account of the crime scene is basically the same. So in my opinion, it's most likely that this is the way the crime scene was. But what does that mean? Many people believe, like I said earlier, that it had something to do with the occult or witchcraft, and this was a ritualistic sacrifice. After releasing their book, the guys would get letters coming in from people about this case. One of the letters was someone who claimed to know a lot about Satanism and said the trapezoid is the occult shape or object for Satanism, and that the trapezoid is a portal between the living and the dead. Some people say that the logs that were around her body were the shape of a trapezoid, and that was the significance of the logs, not that they looked like they were making a coffin. I was able to confirm this myself when I looked into it, that the trapezoid shape is definitely a huge staple in the Church of Satan. I can't go into it too deep here, but the Church of Satan doesn't actually worship the devil. They aren't evil. They espouse to many of the same positive things that most religions have. I encourage you to read more about it if you're interested. But even so, that doesn't mean that they were involved, nor does it mean that the logs around her body were in the shape of a trapezoid. Because from most of the accounts of the people that were at the crime scene, they said that there was a log above her head and one on each side of her body and one below her feet. This would make a four-sided rectangular shape, not a trapezoidal shape. If any of you have any different information about the logs, please tell us about it in the comments. But because of this, I don't believe that this had any significance with the trapezoid. Either way, because of the way the crime scene looked, the theory of the occult being involved really took off. The media was a significant factor in the occult narrative being pushed and glamorized. During one of the interviews Jesse Pollack conducted with investigator Ed Kish, he said during a Union County detective meeting, one of the investigators was asked if anything at the crime scene indicated it was connected to the occult, and he said no. But someone allegedly, supposedly, went to the newspaper after the meeting and said that there was a link, and that started the whole thing. There is some speculation and conflicting stories about how Jeanette was as a person, and I think this also influenced some people's opinion on the occult being responsible. Some people say she was following the occult and practiced witchcraft. Some people say that she was a big partier and she was promiscuous. And some say she was a perfect religious girl. The accounts of Jeanette's friends, though, people who knew her and actually spent time with her, said Jeanette wasn't a big partier. They said that she would go out and drink a little and smoke a little pot once in a while, but that was it. Nothing crazy and nothing more than everyone else was doing. This could just be her friends trying to cover up for her after her death, or they could be telling the truth. I tend to believe their accounts of how Jeanette was over some other people's that gave their opinion on Jeanette to the press. The pastor at the church Jeanette's family attended also had some very questionable and controversial statements about Jeanette not long after she was found. And I personally feel like this was a little out of line, especially for someone who wouldn't have that direct personal relationship or friendship with Jeanette. Jesse Pollack interviewed a professor of contemporary paganism at the University of Bristol and brought him all of the information that was given by all the people at the crime scene. And he said that none of it relates to pagan rituals and were all Christian symbols. Professor Jason Coy, who is an expert in the field of witchcraft, said that modern-day witches have nothing to do with historical witchcraft and are generally peaceful environmentalists, feminists, and practice New Age neo-pagan religion. He theorized that the person who murdered Jeanette may have had a religious fixation. Let's take a few minutes to talk about some other things that were going on in this area of New Jersey to give a little bit more context to try and explain why the occult and witchcraft were on people's minds. A terrible tragedy hit the community less than a year before Jeanette's death, when a family was murdered. The List family included John List, his wife Helen, and their three children, daughter Patricia, who was 16 years old at the time of the murders, 15-year-old son John Jr., and 13-year-old son Frederick. The family lived in a beautiful mansion in Westfield, New Jersey. John List was a successful bank executive and Sunday school teacher. John lacked social skills, though, and this would sometimes result in job losses for him. And in the fall of 1971, that's exactly what happened. John lost his job and was unable to keep up with the bills. And instead of telling his wife and his mom, the other adults that were living in his home, instead of trying to communicate this giant issue with your wife and see what solutions you can come up with together, instead of maybe cutting back on your spending habits a bit, instead of doing any of that, he got up every day, got dressed, and pretended to go to work. He would just sit and read all day before going back home and pretend like he was at work all day. To be fair, he would also be looking at jobs during this time, but by the time that he did finally get a job, he was so far into debt that he didn't think that he could get out of it. In a letter he wrote to his pastor, John said that he couldn't support his family anymore. He recognized that they could just go on welfare, but he didn't want to put his family through that lifestyle. So instead, he shot and killed his three children and his wife. Then he killed his mother because he couldn't let his mother suffer from this tragedy. Real stand-up guy thinking of his family. It has been said that his wife had some mental issues and his daughter was trying to get into acting and was not going to church as much. When the house had been searched and investigated after the bodies were found, investigators found that Patricia, the oldest daughter, had some books on the occult and Wiccan stuff. So because of this, people thought that the occult had something to do with what happened to the List family. Even though John had confessed in these letters to the murder of his family, even though he gave the reasons why he did it, people were still trying to blame witches or the occult on the disgusting, horrific actions of this grown man. The family wasn't found until a month later in December of 1971 because they were supposed to be out of state visiting family for several weeks in November. By the time the police found the bodies, John List was long gone. He wasn't captured until 18 years later when John List was covered on an episode of America's Most Wanted in 1989, and this episode led to his arrest. He was living under a fake identity and was working as an accountant like he did as John List, and he'd even gotten remarried, and this guy was able to do all of this without anyone figuring out who he was. So this happened less than a year before Jeanette was murdered. The Church of Satan was also only founded in 1966, 6 years before Jeanette's murder. It's easier for people to wrap their heads around the devil being the reason why these bad people do bad things, like killing a 16-year-old or a seamlessly perfect family being slaughtered by the father of the family. It's hard for people to accept that people can do and be terrible on their own, and so they just blame the occult and witchcraft. So back to Jeanette's case. The police received a tip early on in the investigation regarding a man who was living in the woods not far from where Jeanette's body was found. This man was known as Red, and according to the man who reported this to police, Red had been coming to the area for about 3 summers and would caddy at the local golf course. The man who called in the tip, who wanted to stay anonymous, said his only reason for finding Red suspicious was where he was living in the woods in proximity to Jeanette's crime scene. The guy said he knew exactly where Red lived because he would give people tours of the crime scene, and he saw that Red left in a hurry shortly after Jeanette's body was discovered, so he was suspicious of him. He claims that he knew where Red lived because of giving these tours, but then how would he know that Red was living there all summer and left right after the body was discovered? So that made me a little suspicious. But then in his interview with Jesse, he said that he knew people who would steal money from Red because they knew he would hide his money at the campsite that he made from caddying at the golf course. And then once Red would leave, the guys would go steal the money from this homeless man. Real winners that this other guy was hanging out with. The caller said he was 21 at the time, and so I'm assuming his friends were on that same age too. And I have to say, it's just really low to steal money from a homeless man, even if you are only in your early 20s. The guy in the interview claimed that he wasn't a part of it, but I don't know if I believe him. Just my opinion. But, I mean, that doesn't mean that he was responsible for Jeanette's disappearance. So this guy gives his own theory of what he thinks happened to Jeanette. He said kids would meet up at the high school parking lot and then go drive up Mountain View Road and smoke weed. Remember, Mountain View Road is the road that is off of the wooded area where Jeanette was found. He theorizes that Jeanette started walking down the road to hopefully catch one of her classmates driving and could get a ride. But then on her way, Red saw her and attacked her. If this was the case, I don't know why he would kill her and then walk her body up onto this hill that is steep and difficult to get up alone, let alone carrying a body as well. Like, why would you do all of that work to put a body so close to where you're living and draw even more attention to yourself? Especially if the murder didn't occur at that spot. Police did look into Red and found his camp area, and police said it looked like he did leave in a hurry, but we don't know the reason. The police cleared Red, but it's not known if they spoke with him and what was said for him to be cleared. I don't know how I feel about this caller, but the theory that he presents brings a new look into a possible route she was taking and who she may have seen and gotten in the car with. There were other murders happening around the same time of Jeanette's murder that had some similarities, but the different police departments really didn't seem to make the connections between them at the time. In 1974, girls in New Jersey were being killed at alarming rates. Two girls aged 13 and 14 were murdered and their bodies were discovered in a wooded area. They were partially nude with electric cords wrapped around their necks. In January and February of 1974, two separate girls were taken and found murdered within days of going missing. They were not sexually assaulted and both occurred in Dover Township, about 20 miles northeast of Springfield, where Jeanette was from. On August 9th, 1974, two friends, Marianne and Lorraine, were 17 and almost 17 at the time, were planning to walk to the mall around 4 p.m. and would be back later in the evening. But when the girls didn't return, Marianne's mom began to worry and called the police to report them missing. Unfortunately, like in Jeanette's case, her mom was told by the police that she had to wait 24 hours before filing the report. Though when she was finally able to make the report, the police said they did not believe that she went missing and they labeled her as a runaway. Again, super similar to the police reaction when Jeanette was reported missing. They spoke with Lorraine's boyfriend and he said that he picked up the girls and drove them a portion of the trip to the mall and then dropped them off along the way to the mall. Ricky, Lorraine's boyfriend, told police that he planned to pick them up from a pre-planned location around 9 p.m. But the girls never showed up. Their bodies were found 5 days later, 20 miles away on a hill by a wooded area. They were naked except for a few pieces of jewelry. Their bodies were lying next to each other, face down with ligature marks from strangulation. The coroner said that their time of death was between 24 and 48 hours before they were found, meaning that they were alive for 3 to 4 days after being taken. The medical examiner was quoted in an article during the time regarding the six murders, and he said that they were dissimilar. But prosecutors and investigators wanted to sit down together and compare everything before they decided they were not related. Whether or not these six murders were related, and if any of them are related to Jeanette's murder, we may never know. But there is one other murder that was similar to Jeanette's. So bear with me as we take a little bit of a detour from discussing Jeanette's case and briefly discuss Joan's case. Joan Kramer was living life to the fullest. She had lupus, and she did not want that to stop her. On August 15th, 1972, she got into an argument with her fiancé and left her parents' house in South Orange, New Jersey. Joan walked to a payphone about a mile away and called a friend from New York to vent about her argument. After this conversation, she crossed the street at South Orange Avenue and Sloan Street and went into the taxi area and then went up to a car and asked for a ride. This was the last time that she was seen. Her parents called the police to file a missing persons report and again were told to wait 24 hours. After the 24 hours, though, the cops did file her as a missing person. The disappearance made national press because of the father's social status, but the police did not really step up with this case and the FBI ended up getting involved. Unfortunately, her body was found in a footpath in Union County. She was nude, but her clothes were found close by. She had been strangled and her body was left lying face down. Both of her necklaces were taken. The investigators in Jeanette's case did not know about the Joan Kramer case until 2013 when they were asked about it from Jesse when interviewing for their book. Though the assistant Union County prosecutor at the time did make a tip line for the two girls' murders, but nothing came of it. No occult connections or speculation came from Joan Kramer's case. There are a few people that police looked at for Joan's murder. 34-year-old Robert Denicki had kidnapped and raped a woman in Westfield in 1972 and a college student in Union in 1971. They decided to give him a polygraph to see if he had any involvement in Joan Kramer's case, and it came back inconclusive. They searched his car after this and found a woman's earring, a handkerchief with the letter K on it, and a map of South Orange. Robert Denicki also lived less than half a mile from where Joan was found. But all of this was circumstantial and nothing ever came of it. When the guys first interviewed the siblings of Joan for their book, they said that someone was in fact arrested for Joan's murder just a few years after the murder. This man was Otto Nilsson. So let's take a few minutes to talk about Otto. Otto Nilsson was an accountant that used to live in South Orange with his wife and five children. They were liked in the neighborhood for many years, but then Otto and Carol started drinking heavily. They would have arguments all of the time and started neglecting their children and their home as their alcoholism got worse and worse. Some neighbors recounted seeing dirty dishes piled up in the kitchen with food rotting on them because of how long they were sitting out. The kids started coming to school with fleas. Things got so bad that the house was eventually condemned and the children had to be taken to the hospital for treatment. Eventually, Otto started getting physically abusive with his wife and kids. After one violent outburst, Carol kicked Otto out of the house. After kicking him out, Carol began suspecting if Otto had anything to do with a murder that occurred about 6 years prior to this, of 17-year-old Carol Farino. On November 3rd, 1966, Carol Farino had finished her shift at a restaurant in Maplewood and began walking the 10 blocks home. At 8:44 p.m., Maplewood police would receive a call from a woman on Hubert Place saying that there was a person's body laying in the neighbor's driveway on Sunset Place. When police arrived, they found Carol's body at the end of her driveway next to a tree. She was so close to making it home. Her shoes were missing, her girdle was pulled down around her right ankle, and her stocking was tied around her neck. They attempted to resuscitate her, but were unsuccessful, and she was pronounced dead at 9:05 p.m. Her underwear and waitress uniform were undisturbed, so it seems like this guy was only taking her shoes and girdle off so that he could get to her stockings so he could use it to strangle her. There was a witness who saw a man about 30 minutes before Carol's body was found walking north on Hubert Place and cross Summer Avenue before hesitating and then turning to head west on Somerset. A police officer was at the restaurant where Carol worked and told his supervisor that he saw a tall, slim man with red hair, possibly in his 20s. A coworker at George's corroborated the sighting, but nothing happened in the case for 6 years. Not until shortly after Jeanette and Joan were murdered. This was when Carol Nilsson, Otto's wife, began wondering if Otto had anything to do with the waitress that was murdered just 9 blocks away 6 years before. Then Joan Kramer was murdered, and Carol Nilsson felt like she had to say something and ended up telling a friend about her suspicions. And then, a few days later, Carol's suspicions only heightened when the newspaper printed the witness sketch by Springfield police of the man seen picking up Joan Kramer. And it looked very similar to Otto. It looked so much like him that their kids and their friends even commented about how much it looked like Otto. I don't believe Carol told investigators about her suspicions at the time. Then in July 1974, Carol took her children on vacation over the weekend. Otto had been out of the house for a while at this point, but Otto decided this weekend he wanted to show up at Carol's house to visit with the kids. But then when no one was there, Otto decided to go across the street to their neighbor's house because he was convinced the neighbor, William Gregg, was hiding his family from him. He flew into a violent rage and assaulted William and his two sons. When he was arrested, police started to make connections between Otto and the sketch they had from the Carol Farino case. So they began to quietly start looking into Otto. When he was arrested, Otto had to undergo a mandated 15-day psychiatric evaluation at Cedar Grove's Overbrook Asylum, and then received a 2-year suspended sentence and was ordered to stay out of South Orange and away from his ex-wife. The day after he returned to his Maplewood apartment, two teenage girls would go missing while shopping at a mall 30 minutes from Otto's apartment. These girls were Marianne and Lorraine, the two girls I mentioned earlier when discussing the cases that were similar to Jeanette's. And like I said earlier, the two girls were found in a wooded area face down. That was kind of the end of the similarities between Jeanette and Jones' cases. Lorraine and Marianne were hogtied, and glass bottles were present in their genital area. There was no clothing or pocketbooks found in the area, and one of the girls had a necklace and a bracelet on. The other girl had a necklace on. The medical examiner said that they were suffocated and had been dead, like I said earlier, up to 40 hours, and believe that their bodies were stored somewhere else prior to being placed where they were found. It was also discovered that Lorraine was killed about 6 hours before Marianne. The same day the girls went missing, Otto sent his judge a letter, and this letter was him trying to justify his actions when assaulting his former neighbors. If you want to hear more detail about his letter, you can find it in Jesse Pollack's podcast. But basically, he said that the day before the assault, he tried to see how much alcohol he could drink in 5 minutes. And so he drank, allegedly, 2/3 fifth of gin, over half a fifth of dry vermouth, a fifth of sweet vermouth, and half a pint of scotch. He wanted to see if he could do it, I guess. And he said he vomited and fell asleep. And the next day was when he committed the assault on his neighbors. He tried using this long explanation of his mental and physical activities from when he was young and then throughout his adult life, and how the change in his activity, both physically and mentally, decreased so much as an adult that when he began drinking, he couldn't metabolize the alcohol correctly, and that when the alcohol was storing in his body, it was causing the breakdown of a protein needed for his brain to function correctly. He tried to say the alcohol was stored as too much energy in his body because of the way his body was not breaking it down, and it caused hallucinations to occur, followed by bouts of depression. He read a couple chapters of a microbiology textbook and tried to explain how the alcohol was breaking down the proteins in his brain and how the hallucinations were occurring. And honestly, there are tons of issues that can arise with how your body breaks down alcohol. How your age, gender, ethnicity can all affect the way that your body breaks it down. What type of alcohol it is, what type of mixers you use, what type of foods you eat before, during, and after, if you eat at all, if you're taking any medications, prescriptions, or otherwise. Our bodies are very complex and there are a lot of factors, but when it comes down to it, he still decided to drink all of that alcohol. He knows the normal side effects of alcohol. He should know that it was a bad idea, and he should be held accountable for his actions. Anyways, if Otto did kill Lorraine and Marianne, then while he was writing this letter to the judge, they were likely locked up. Jesse Pollack went to Maplewood to see the apartment where Otto lived to see if there was any way that he could have kept the girls locked up somewhere. At first, he thought this was unlikely because it sat on the corner of a busy intersection. But after actually going there, he found that the parking lot that the tenants would park in the back of the building, there was a small Bilco door that was likely attached to a utility room or a storage room in the back of the building, and it was right at the edge of the parking lot. So it was possible that Otto could have backed up to the door, taken the girls out of the trunk, and right down through the door. It's unclear, though, if Otto was on police's radar for Marianne or Lorraine's cases. The murders are still unsolved, and information is not open to the public. But in South Orange County, investigators had spent several months investigating Nilsson and if there were any possible involvement in Joan Kramer's murder. On January 9, 1975, 53-year-old South Orange resident Mary Collado claimed to witness a man picking up a female hitchhiker in South Orange Village on the night that Joan Kramer was murdered. Mary was shown a picture of Otto Nilsson by investigators, and she positively identified him as the driver. Based on this witness account, a judge issued an arrest warrant, and 24 hours later, the Essex County investigators arrested Nilsson. Otto chose not to enter a plea and was held without bail. Then, the next night, the community was shocked by another horrific tragedy. But that we will have to wait for next time, because this was the end of part one, and we will get into that in part two. Thank you for being here with me, and I will see you in the next part. Make sure to hit the subscribe button and hit the bell so that you're notified when part two of this case comes out. And I will see you there. Bye.